Hello everyone. So today we're going to take a look at mastering. This video in particular is going to be a little bit different than a standard tutorial video. The reason being is that I have kind of this more information research thing going on that I kind of want to present. I felt that that stuff was going to be, when presented all together, it's going to be a lot more valuable than just showing you kind of a mastering chain or kind of an end result. So I'll kind of get down to it. Also tell you a little bit of what's going on here. So I've done a mixed series called Let's Mix a Song. And in that series, I mixed the song All Over Town by Gypsy Mobile. And once we finished all of the songs, the band sent off all of these files for mastering, and they chose to send it to Howie Weinberg, who's basically a world-renowned mastering engineer. He's got a whole whack of gold and platinum records. World-renowned, here we go, 200 gold records. He's got over 3,000 releases, so he's a pretty bang-on kind of guy, you know, for mastering. You send him your stuff and it's going to be awesome. And you can check out his website here. I'll provide a link, but here's a bunch of stuff that you've probably heard of. So anywho, they send it off to him. We get all the files back and all is well. And all the masters sound pretty darn sweet. So I kind of just decided one day, like, you know, I'm going to A/B the mix that I have, try and get as close of a master as his that I can get just by A/Bing and using a bunch of plugins and stuff. And I kind of came up with something pretty darn close. So maybe what I'll do is I'll just play back his master, which is this one right here, and then I'll show you what I ended up with, which is, this is the exported file, and this is the file with the plugins on it. So let's have a listen here, just so we can kind of A/B compare, see what it sounds like. So this is how it's mastered. Nice and full, a little bit of crunch, good bottom end, nice EQ, and what I ended up getting. I can see in your eyes. Very similar. I think, now that I'm listening back to it, I think I have a little bit more distortion stuff happening. But anywho's, I'll move on here. So, essentially what I wanted to do right off the bat was kind of just get an idea of what he does. So what kind of processing does he use? So I did a little bit of research, I went on his website, he's got some pictures here. So I found three kind of relevant pictures. I noticed that these here are some Pultex, and in these pictures he doesn't have Pultex there. Then I realized that on the link here, 2011, this is an older picture than this one, which is 2012. And this one is also 2012. So I'm assuming he took these out and started using this stuff here, or this thing right here, in 2012, I don't know, whatever, but anyways, he's got Pultex, he's got all this gear, so I did a little bit of some nerdy Google searching, and I found out that he's got, let's go to this right here, so he's got a Focusrite Red 3 compressor, he's got a a custom-built SSL bus compressor, and I know that from this video, this YouTube video interview thing that I'll also give you guys the link for, which is that SSL custom is quite close, or should be quite close to a G-series stereo compressor. What else does he have? There's the L2 hardware version of Waves, which is this guy. There's this and this guy, which is a Sontek EQ and another kind of Sontek EQ. Then he has this device in here, which is kind of a just a monitoring device, and it routes things. So it's like a patch bay kind of thing, and it provides the monitoring. I couldn't find what this device or this. This is a power distributor. I think this is like a durometer, maybe. Not sure. This device looks like another power meter or power conditioner. This device I couldn't find. This device here is a SPL pass EQ, passive EQ, I think it's called. And then we got this guy right there, which is a master clock. And he also has this Antelope Zodiac Plus D to A converter, which is in this picture right here. So essentially, I've kind of just figured out what he's using. And in this interview, he also mentions that he doesn't really like plugins, unless they're doing specific things like noise removal or tape emulation. In this mix here, on the master bus of the mix, I put on a tape emulation. So in this mastering chain, I'm not using tape emulation. So that is that. That's as far as my research kind of went. So next thing was, I'm going to try to mimic what he may have been using on the master that he sent our way. So basically, what do I got here? I don't think he has a multiband compressor, but just felt like I'd show you that. An SSL bus compressor, that's what I'm using. This is similar to a Poltec. It's a little bit different. It doesn't have the same kind of thing, but it's based off the same idea. And I think it might just be modeling a different series of some sort. So we got that. This passive EQ, which I think is quite similar to this SPL. And then we have the L2 plugin version. And then I'm also using this soft clipper to give it more of a drive analog feel. And that's kind of ramming it into the limiter. So let's go down through this thing plug by plug. And I'll actually just leave the limiter on because it'll give me more volume. And that way I don't have to turn everything up and you don't have to turn everything up. So let's start from scratch here. Let's hear what we got. This is the master, his master. So we need more volume. The EQ definitely sounds different as well. So there's some balancing that has to be done. So to begin with here, I cut off all this low-end rumble stuff. This stuff is kind of unnecessary for this kind of a track. Anything from below 22 hertz, we don't need. Cut that off abruptly. And then we're dipping from somewhere around, looks like about 50, it's starting to dip, or close to 60. Just kind of a nice, not even that much really, like at its peak, it's cutting about -7. And that's at like 22 hertz. So a That's actually a preset here. This one right here. Remove DC lower rumble. And make sure to take your dither off, because you don't want to do multiple instances of dithering. That's just raising your noise floor unnecessarily. So we got that. So that doesn't change the sound very much. It's just cleaning up the signal before it's going to hit any of the compressors. So basically, all of this cutout information is now not going to be triggering any of these compressors. Most importantly would be the 2-bus compressor. We don't want that stuff to be triggering the 2-bus, because if that's going to be setting off the compression, it's going to be affecting the whole track and not just a specific band. In the multiband, it would be okay if it was triggering just this band, and it wouldn't be affecting all this other stuff. But so yeah, take this low end rumble out, and then we're dealing with a cleaner signal. So now we have this linear phase multiband compressor, which is just gonna take all of the, it's like take the whole signal, split it into specific bands, in this case 5, and then compress anything that's kind of just poking out at those certain frequencies. So I began with just a flat signal, not much of a threshold at all. The range was quite limited, so there wasn't going to be that much compression. The knee is set to fairly hard. Yeah, so just I started with that, and then I started A-B-ing, and then I decided to kind of EQ it a little bit with this thing here. So let's have a listen with and without. I can see in your eyes, and I can tell by your smile, that you've been all over town. It's been a long, long mile. So you can hear all that top end stuff kind of carved out. I didn't really kind of think too much of it. I just moved it and it sounded close to what he had, so I kept it. But that was when I had all of these plugins enabled. So right now what you're hearing, it sounds like a harsh top end cut, and to me I wouldn't have done this. That sounds like quite a harsh cut, right? I'm thinking that this is actually doing something quite similar to what a Pultec would be doing at the top end, is it's taking out quite a bit of that top end, and then when I'm adding stuff in this passive EQ and adding a little bit up here at 10k with this kind of Pultec style thing here, I'm basically using this plugin plus the enhanced plus the passive to kind of mimic a Pultec sound. So I think that's why it's matching quite nicely. So, but let's look at the compression. You're a digit in love, with no regrets or denial. I should have known all along. So there's actually very little compression going on, but I used it as the multiband compression and kind of an EQ here. So that was that. And then I ran that into the bus compressor. So without. You're a digit in love. With no regrets or denial. I should have known all along. You're just not my style. So that's giving it a nice sound to it. Every time the kick is punching in, it's making it kind of sound fat, and then it has like a thing going on with the release. It makes it sound a lot punchier, and it's kind of gluing the song together and giving me more loudness, more of that RMS that I'm looking for. Basically, in this setting, the auto was fluctuating too much It was changing throughout the song. You could hear it dip, get qu too quiet, and then it would jump. It was pumping, that kind of thing. It wasn't working. These settings were a little too long, and it was doing kind of pumping, but it just wasn't working. Point two and point one were too loud, and they weren't accentuating the transients. It wasn't like dancing with the music. Point four was doing a much better job. The four ratio and the threshold here were working quite well.
And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town. It's been a long, long mile. You're a digital love.
So four is kind of like a happy medium from being too squashy to not doing too much. So that's a good setting. The threshold I won't adjust too much. Now with this enhanced EQ, you'll notice I've cut more than I've boosted, but when I engage it, you'll probably hear more of a low end than without the plug.
And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town.
Maybe not more per se, but it's sculpting it in a way that's more polished. So that sounds quite cool. I've also cut just a slight bit at 20 hertz, and I've boosted at the 10. So it's doing like a smiley face, kind of a polish to the song, and you can hear that.
And I can tell by your smile.
Much more pleasing. Now with this passive EQ, I'm doing some mid-side stuff here. So on the mid section, which is on the left-hand side here, no high pass filter, but a low pass at 18K. And at this low end here, from 150 hertz and below, I've got quite a harsh boost. So the slope is quite harsh and the boost is quite high. So what that's doing is it's taking all of my low end information and centering it down the middle. So it's going to make the song's low end energy be a lot tighter and a little bit more punchy. And then on the sides, I've done the exact same slope and the exact same frequency, and I'm cutting that out from the sides. So I'm shifting the low end stuff from the sides down to the middle. And that's, like I said, it's going to make it a little bit more punchy and a little bit more tight in that low end. Also in the mids, I've cut out about 180 hertz. Not much, but in relative to all these other boosts, it's essentially going to be like three or four cut when you kind of take into account what all the other things are doing at 180, which is kind of more of the mud of a song. And again, a harsh slope here. And then I'm boosting from 220. It's a shelf, not too harsh of a shelf. Just kind of a general boost, and that's just accentuating this clearing out the mud, giving it a smiley face polish. And then once again at 3.9K, a little bit harsher of a slope, and then boosting that quite a bit. So let's solo the mids and hear what's going on.
And I can tell by your smile.
Makes a drastic difference.
I should have known all along.
And now on the sides, like I said, I was cutting this exact opposite on the the sides. Then on this low mids here, I boosted this at 560 with a very general kind of cue here. Boosted quite a lot. I don't think this is something that I would have heard on my own, but when I was A-B-ing to Howie's mix, or Howie's master, I boosted it there and it sounded more like his. So I think it sounds better for it. Now that I've A-B'd it and I hear this working here at this frequency, it sounds more balanced and just better. And then at 470, which is even actually just below this, I'm doing a nice, a decent shelf slope here, boosting it a little bit. And then from 1.8K, doing a decent shelf slope here, boosting quite a bit. So giving it more polish again. And this is kind of opening up the sides to the top end information. So it's making it a little bit more wide and crisp on the top end. So let's hear what that sounds soloed. Sounds quite weird.
It's been a long, long
time. When soloed, of course. And I'm boosting the sides by 0.8 dB, and that's just going to widen the song just a little bit. Instead of using like some kind of an imager tool, I'm just boosting the sides, and it's making it sound a little bit wider. Now let's A-B once again with this thing.
And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town.
So that's probably the biggest difference out of all of these plugins is this guy right here. And I think that's because I'm doing the mid side, and also I'm doing some harsh boosts, harsh cuts, quite a bit of stuff here going on, right? Oh yeah, also on the sides I'm doing a high pass at 68, which is just gonna take off most of the sub frequencies from the sides. But with this harsh cut already at 150, lots of the low end information is gone, but I'm also just high passing from there on. So yeah, there's that plugin. And then for some reason I felt that it was still not very bassy, or not bassy enough, at least in compared to Howie's master.
And I can tell by
so now let's compare them.
That you've been all over town. It's been a long, long mile.
So obviously there's a lot more crunch and loudness in his still. But the bass, when they're matched in volume, was still a little bit different. So I put this max bass. Instead of boosting more bass, I put a max bass to generate harmonics of those low frequencies. So I've cut 6 dB from the original bass, added in quite a bit of the max bass, harmonics. And that way you can hear low end stuff better on small speakers, so like laptop speakers and stuff. So let's hear the difference with and without.
And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town.
So to me that sounds like it's pushing just a little harder when the kicks come in. It's doing something a little bit more, just a little bit more like a punch in your face, kick or bass feel. Yeah, it just sounds a little bit better.
And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town.
And it's also transferring some of the sub frequencies to higher frequencies. So it's going to give me a little bit more headroom too because of that reason. And like I said, I'm going to be hearing more low-end quote-unquote frequencies like you hear low-end information on smaller speakers better with this plugin. So yeah, and then the kind of last difference, of course, other than the limiting, is I'll just A/B it. So from my master, and I can tell by your smile, to Howie's, that you've been all over town. It's been a long, long, is some of that crunch, and it's like analog running into digital crunch. That's kind of what's going on. So I'm mimicking that with a soft clipper. So let's hear the difference. And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town. It's been a long, long mile. You're a digit alone. So that's giving me the last bit of volume running into the limiter. It's also giving me the crunch because it's sort of soft clipping, which is a little bit of distortion. And that's running into the L2. L2, I have the ARC going on, the automatic release control. And I got the threshold way down. So you can see the attenuation is probably peaking at -8, it looked like. And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town. Probably an average of -6-ish, 5-ish. You're a digit alone. So yeah, that's all the plugins. So now that we have a good idea of what I've done and we know what it sounds like, let's A/B once again between the two. Between Howie's master and then my mimic. And I can tell by your smile that you've been all over town. It's been a long, long mile. You're a digit alone with no regrets or denial. I should have known all along. What she means to me. Don't make a sound. So obviously it's not like a perfect match or anything, but it's quite close, and it's a lot closer than I've ever been able to get to a kind of professional sounding master. Most specifically as far as RMS goes. But also with the balance in the EQ and stuff, and just having the low end kind of right, and the top end right, and the mid information right, and the compression right, all of that kind of stuff. This is probably the best that I've ever gotten. And I'm kind of privileged in this case. Like, the only reason I could do that is because I'm A/B-ing a mix that I've sent, like, a top-of-the-line mastering engineer to master, and then I can compare my mix to his master and try and match that. So I was kind of lucky in this case. Yeah, hopefully you guys kind of get the gist of it. Maybe you find yourself in a similar situation where you can A/B between your mixes and a professional's master of your mix, to kind of get an idea of how to get a good master like that. If not, then just kind of follow these same kind of steps that I'm doing, and you'll probably find yourself somewhere close. Hopefully this kind of gives you a good rundown of how to match a professional quality master in the box with probably plugins that you have at your disposal. If you don't have the exact plugins, then just find something that's quite close and figure something out, I guess. So the main point here is just to demonstrate that it is possible to get a good master on your own. However, in my case here, what I'm doing is I'm A-Bing between a professional master who has mastered a mix that I did and mastering my mix to that. So this is kind of a special case here. In a very similar way, you can take random tracks that you want to kind of mimic the sound of. So let's say there's a... let's say I wanted to mimic this track here to a mastered version of the Arkells band. One of like that, Oh, the Boss is Coming song. If I wanted to match it to that, I would bring that song up in here into this session, and then I would kind of A-B it along the way, matching the EQs, matching the dynamics, matching the distortion qualities, all of that, and then hopefully I would get something that's quite close and a good final master. So yeah, hopefully that gives you ideas and helps you, and catch you in the next video. So take care. Bye-bye.